Alexa, open BraveWords Radio.
Welcome back to BraveWords Radio. Brought to you by Vox Protocol, the global leader in voice app entertainment. BraveWords Radio is an awesome musical extension of BraveWords.com, where we have been waving the flag of hard rock and heavy metal around the world for over 30 years. Since you have been here before, we hope you enjoy BraveWords Radio.
Please welcome to Streaming for Vengeance, Mr. Joe Lynn Turner. You're looking fan-freaking-fantastic, sir.
Thank you, Tim. Appreciate that. I feel good.
Now, I need to take you back to April because Peter and I have had a long-standing friendship. We were one of the first magazines to really support Hypocrisy in North America. So we're going back into the 90s. And he's a great friend, a great talent. We're huge fans of all his work and his studio. And he played me this new music in April because it was one of the first shows that had come through Toronto post-COVID. And he said, Tim, listen to this. And I'm like, is that Joe Lynn Turner singing? I'm like, wow. So this is not really a surprise, but it's certainly musically it is a surprise, and it's coming from a fairly dark place in your soul. Tell me about it.
Well, I mean, look, we all have light and dark. We all have angels and devils, you know, and it all depends on what you release at what time, I think. And I think it's been brewing for over 5 years. That's great that you had a preview of it, by the way, I might add. That's cool that Peter, you know, showed you that. But anyway, I waited about 5 years to really do a solo album. And I had discussed that with Peter so that the impact would be as it is deservedly now. I did projects, you know, a couple of one-offs, tribute here and there, whatever. But I did not do a solo album. We were holding this. And we worked, we started before pandemic. In fact, we wrote the first song, Don't Fear the Dark, like maybe 4 or 5 months after we met. He threw me a track, and I wrote to it, sent it back, and he loved it. And that's when we decided to do something. So basically, we did two. I went to his studio, The Abyss, did two songs there. The chemistry was just off the hook. It was amazing. I mean, he was writing as I was writing melodies and lyrics, and it just all came together. So we knew we had something. And then the pandemic hit, and of course, everything became virtual. Right. So, and then we continued to work that way, and then eventually found each other in the studio again when things lifted a bit, and finished it in a day and a half, I think it was. And then he took it back to mix, master, and so on.
So who approached who from the get-go? And did you know about this person, Peter Tägtgren?
Well, you know, I knew about the bands, but I wasn't extremely familiar with him. I became actually familiar with him through my wife, Maya, who was a big fan in the early days because she's younger than I was. And but when he started doing Lindemann, because I'm a big fan of Rammstein, I mean, that's when it all started to connect. So I went back into the catalog of Peter, saw what he was doing with Hypocrisy and with Pain. And Lindemann, I think, thought was just brilliant. So and we went to a few shows with Lindemann and Rammstein. Peter was there. So the friendship and the association collaboration just continued, you know, and I was very familiar with this stuff after that.
You just answered one of my questions coming up about being a Rammstein Lindemann fan, because Rammstein, they do very few shows in North. They just played Quebec City to 40,000 people last week. Like the enormity of Rammstein is just like, and the fact that actually Peter's working with the main guy. So it's cool that you went kind of back, you put all the pieces of the puzzle together.
Yeah, that's right. We became friends with Till when we were in New York. We went to the show, the after parties, just about everywhere, wherever he was. And it became a nice little clique, so to speak, you know, and I guess that's where the energy, all the energy prevailed from. you know.
Now, on my bucket list is to visit the Abyss Studios. So tell me about walking into the Abyss and all the history and everything there.
Well, I mean, it's a little more remote outside of Bolanga, Sweden, about 2 hours by train north of Stockholm and Arlanda Airport. And then you travel about 45 minutes in. And Peter owns two homes on that huge lot near a lake, and the Abyss is right off the lake. So it's a great setting, and very quiet, very comfortable, so you can focus on work and et cetera. And the studio is just state of the art. When I say brand new, it still looks like a brand new building, beautiful inside. I mean, his setup is just Star Trek, you know, it's like amazing. So real comfortable studio to work in and create in, actually. And of course, he's doesn't only have the main room, but he's got a small studio in the back of that where Jonas works out of. And there's a co-write with Jonas on this album as well called Requiem. So, he got in the act. Plus, he plays the solo. He did a demo solo on Don't Fear the Dark. And we loved it so much, we said, that's solo. That's not a demo. Just keep it. When something sounds right, it's right. You know, it fits. So
we Brave Words has always been very fond of like the more darker places of heavy metal, the black metal and the death metal, and Scandinavia. It's just the climate. You talk about Norway and Swedish. You know what I mean? All these really extreme bands, and a lot of it is because they're just inside. There's no light. So how does that affect this recording?
Well, I mean, I think it affects the personality. I mean, I use pretty much exclusively a Swedish band, you know, musicians. Right. There must be something in the water, you know, because they're exceptional musicians. They are writers. I've been writing with people in Sweden for years. And I mean, over two decades, probably, whether it was AOR stuff or whatever, you know. So Sweden has that reputation of just, Finland's getting there as well. So this darker, what do they have in the winter, 2 hours of light or something, you know, it's got to affect you. It affects your personality, your psychology, your emotionality, everything, you know. So it's pretty natural to go there, into that space. And they do it really well.
Now, we've heard one song. I've heard the whole thing, but collectively, people have heard one song. And this is probably taking a few people aback, maybe even scaring the shit out of them.
Yeah, I got that. It scares the shit out of them. Some say it's too brutal, too honest, too dark. Can't believe it's me. This is not your kind of music, you know, and all of it. It's a one-off or something. No, this is coming right from the heart and soul of both of us. And, Peter was kind of the vehicle that I needed in order to express this type of message and emotion, really, you know, to get this across. And we both knew that because we're like-minded in a lot of ways as far as the way we look at the world and what's happening. So we're very compatible with that as well. Plus, we wanted to make something, which I think you'd agree, is a melodic metal record. It still has choruses, you know, it's not throat singing or any of that. So it's got some elements of the classic part of what I do and all the elements of what Peter does, and you put them together, mix them up in a pot, and I think the record came out like just, you know, killer. Like with the ballads, for example, I've been asked about the ballads and they are part of my background, except with the modernization and metal treatment of the instrumentation. So you put that together, I adapt the voice a little bit to that darkness, plus the subject matter. I mean, like Dark Night of the Soul, that's about my heart attack, man. That's about laying on a slab and the doctor's telling you don't know if you're going to live or die. You don't get more death oriented than that. Right. That's the truth. And it's about a man coming towards his end and looking at his life and saying, did I do it for love? Did I do it for gold? Was I a fool? Was I wise? it answers the asks these questions. So it all fits.
That's what I have on this little piece of paper. It has Tortured Soul, Dark Night of the Soul, and Requiem. And I'm like, these are the more laid back, mellow, if you want to call it, but very dark, obviously, and ultimately very personal.
Very personal. Yeah, they are. I mean, look, I think an artist has to reflect, has to somehow transmute through his own soul, through his own humanness. And art reflects life. And I was reflecting what happened to me, and I'm not alone in this. I'm not the only person that feels this way or that it's happened to. And I think that that unites people when you get that personal. I mean, I know in my life when I would listen to an artist and he was baring his soul, it meant a lot more to me than Moon, June, Spoon, I love you, you know. Right. I mean, that's all good, you know, on pop side of things, but it doesn't last very long in your ethos, you know. It doesn't shake you. And the stuff that I love goes deep into the soul, goes deep into your personal aspect, dark, light, or however, you know, doesn't matter.
I just want to step back about the whole, you kind of brought up the whole Cookie Monster growl effect, which this album is not, but a lot of the older demographic in my circles working in retail and stuff, they really weren't afraid. Like they were afraid of bands like Opeth because of that vocal change. Right.
Right.
So, but you're approaching this a little bit differently because there's no growl in here. It's just these glorious classic Joe Lynn Turner vocals.
With an edge.
Get
a little grit in there, and I put a little more attitude in it. I mean, when Peter was asked, you know, hey, how's the Joe Lynn Turner album coming? He said, it's coming out cool. And they said, well, how does he do in the singing end of it? And he said, quite honestly, he said, well, he adapts his voice. that's exactly the truth, adaptation. So you always sing to... you always sing to the color of the music. You know, if it has a dark tone, you sing with a dark tone. You don't sing a happy song in a death metal, you know, basic instrumentation. It just doesn't work, right? So it's pretty natural.
And obviously heavy keeps you young because I'm talking to a man that's 71. Yeah. And you know what I mean? All these little peons that are bitching about how heavy this is, they can just like go to hell.
You know what? What's wrong with heavy? Yeah. I mean, I was listening to heavy. And to be honest with you, you know, I started to get sucked into AOR because I have a good AOR voice, but I also have this side of me. I also have the blues side of me. I also have an opera side of me. I mean, this is an instrument that can go a lot of different ways. And it's all truthful because it's an instrument. It's what you put into it that comes out of it. So what's wrong with heavy and what's wrong with dark and what's wrong with any of that? That's part of life, man. Don't tell me you're all happy and, you know, and peppy and loved. It's not all, that's not the truth. Truth is we're on some dark days here, which reminds me of an old song I did on a Slam album, solo album. It's called Slam, Eye for an Eye. I had all these dark titles. And you know what? People were like, oh, we don't want to hear that. I mean, you know, what do they want? Fruit cups and flowers? I mean, you want reality? You want art? You want something to move you and shake you? You got to dig deep. That's where you got to go, into your very soul. Otherwise, you're just on the surface playing around.
It's not about seasons in the sun, right?
Hell no, not for me.
What do you think about some of these classic rock guys that just don't want to rock anymore, though? Like the Rod Stewarts, the Jeff Becks, the Elton Johns. I mean, I'd love Rod Stewart too. Apparently he's doing a Faces reunion, but you know what I mean? It seems that heavy is keeping you young.
Yeah, what's keeping me young is not resting on my laurel, not repeating myself as most of these guys still do. You know, you keep repeating album after album, and it starts to get so droll and boring, and you've heard it before. And in a lot of ways, they think that's what the people want, because people are generally, in my opinion, afraid of change. But yet, change, as you and I both know, is the only thing that keeps you alive.
Right.
In the I Ching, for example, the book of change, that's life. You know, things must change. Everything must pass. Everything must move. Everything must change, like the seasons. And you have to change and evolve with it. So as an artist, I'm changing and evolving within my own frame of reference, which happened in my life. You know, I'm not going to come off the, for example, whether it's a heart attack or a whatever, I'm not going to come off and start singing, you know, hey, happy days, you know. I'm going to sing about it. I'm going to let you know, this is what happened to me. Maybe it happened to you.
But you've never been afraid, really, of any genre. Your resume, you just want to fucking sing. Pardon my F-bomb. That's all you want to do.
You know what? Look, I've been gifted and blessed with a voice that can adapt to many different things and different levels, from the pop to the hard rock to melodic rock. And even if I wanted to get heavier on the metal side of things, I could probably get into that too. But I tried to find a modicum of some space with this record where it was actually still me. So in other words, as Peter said, we're going to keep it referenced from your classic side of things, you know, melodic metal. But, you know, because you shouldn't be in throat singing, Joe. That's just not you. And he didn't write Hypocrisy riffs either, for me, you know.
Right.
So we kind of formulated the fact that he always told me, I have a vision. And I said, go with the vision, you know, and this was it. He created the bedrock for me to sort of skate over, you know, and still adapt to that mission, which is message, music and message.
Is there any intention to throw this onto the road?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is roadworthy stuff. This is what I'm looking forward to, apparently in 23, because right now, as you know, things are pretty chaotic.
Absolutely.
And I'm not going to get in the mix of that. You know, you can't even get a gig anymore now because everybody and their mother is out there.
Yeah.
You know, and they're all, the pandemic just stifled everybody so much that there's just no room. The venues are all full. The bands are all, they're lowering their prices, whatever it takes to get out there. And I just said, look, let's go to 23. We'll set everything up. The record, full record's coming out in October anyway. We'll let Christmas go by. Come January, we'll have time to set up some dates. And let's hit the road.
Can we step back into your past for a moment?
Absolutely.
What is a project that you had your heart and soul set on, but it didn't click? What is something that you lose sleep at night and go, why did this not do it?
That's an interesting question. Nobody's ever asked me that before. I mean, look, from one album with Deep Purple, it was, I have to say, a disappointment, but it wasn't like, I knew what was happening. I knew why it was happening. I knew that they got this huge deal from BMG to get Gillan back in the band. You can't pass up a couple of million dollars like that.
Right.
So they were like, Joe, sorry. You know, but everybody says, oh, Joe was fired. I wasn't really fired. I was let go. I was explaining the situation. And I said, let me bow out to let Purple come forward again, because I always loved Purple. You know, it was a band that, I was a big fan of the band for my whole life. So, I feel, as Ian Pace said, I love this comment, and I have a screenshot of it, and I'll paraphrase it. He basically said, Joe Lynn Turner was the link. We would have never got to Perfect Strangers or anything if he hadn't been there for Slaves and Masters, because Richie would have bolted. Richie would have left and done something else, and then there would have been no sort of chance for them to regroup. So I kind of was the middleman to keep it together. And he said many other kind words about me. You know, I love the guy, but I mean, not because he's flattering me, but because he's accurate.
Right.
And I knew that was the accuracy. You know, we got so much flack for that album, but honestly, Tim, you listen to the album, it's a damn good album.
Yeah, it is. Absolutely. It's stood the test of time. It has stood the test of time.
That exactly. The writing, the production, the performances. Come on, it's a good record, you know.
But despite you're only on one Deep Purple record, that's a hell of a thing to have on a resume.
Oh, yeah. I'm proud of it. I'm honored and blessed to be on it. You know, I was very fortunate. I mean, they had somebody lined up to be a singer, and I was the last minute call. Because at that point, Colin Hart, the road manager, called me and said, "You fancy coming up to Vermont to audition?" And I said, "I got to audition." He said, "Oh, you know what I fucking mean." And I went, "Yeah, okay." So I drove up to Vermont, and there they were in this beat up old abandoned ski lodge in the bar area, stinking of cigarettes and beer. And as soon as I walked in, Blackmore started playing "Hey Joe," and I went right to the mic. And then John Lord, rest his soul, he started playing this piano bit, and that turned into "The Cut Runs Deep" right there and then. And they looked at each other after the jam and said, "He's the guy." And Richie went, "I told you, he could write, he can sing, he looks for it. There it is. We got him." And they all said, "That's it." And that's how it happened. In a way, last minute. But I must say, at that time, I was already coming out. I was in Foreigner and out of Foreigner. Right. That's because during the time when Lou had quit, I call it the "say you will" period. Okay. And I had a falling out with Bud Prager, the manager, because he was a complete arsehole. And I just told him he was. You don't do that, right? And then Bad Company was also interested in a singer before they got Brian Howe.
Wow.
So it was a peak of my leg of a career. And I went, I want to go with Purple. And that's what I did. And I never looked back. And I don't regret a damn minute of it.
Well, when you look at the lineage of singers, it's a pretty exclusive grouping.
You know what? Absolutely. That legacy, to be part of that, I am so blessed and fortunate. Really, I am. You know, it's like pinch me. It's a dream. Really.
Now, you brought up the word AOR, and reflecting on how heavy this record was, when in the early 80s, there was a big transition. You know, you had Maiden and Priest out there, but you had like the Big Four was starting to become big. And I remember being in high school listening to this new band called Metallica, and I would never have dreamt ever that I'd be sitting here and they're the biggest band on the planet. So where were you at singing your lovely melodies? And then Kill 'Em All was coming out. Show No Mercy was coming out. You know what I mean? Were you aware of that scene?
Master of Puppets. Yeah. Well, they were opening for us at a certain point, opening for Rainbow.
Yeah, right.
And the story is that they left about an hour ahead of us to the next gig. And as we were driving on this cold, rainy highway, we saw these lights up ahead of us, and that's when the bus turned over. Okay.
Oh. So
we drove right up and stopped. And of course the police were, you know, this, that, and the other thing, but unfortunately they couldn't get him out from under. And I mean, it was, so I was there. We were there. Yeah. I mean, we've got all kinds of stories that would wait till the book comes out.
Yeah, sorry. I'm gonna put Metallica means a lot to me, and that was all deaths are brutal, but that was just a horrific, horrific time for the band.
Horrific. Well, aside from that, Lars and Deep Purple was like the favorite band. I mean, they inducted them. That's their favorite band, right?
Here we go. This is, you've got all these extreme bands, but they were influenced on Rainbow, Saxon, Maiden, Priest. Right? Influence, yeah. You caused the problem.
Yeah, probably. I mean, we always felt instrumental in developing the melodic hard rock, you know, and Europe kind of took shape after that and during that and all that. And we always get credited with that, I guess is how you'd put it, that we developed the integrity of hard rock, but at the same time melodic and with choruses and all that. So it was not pop at all. I mean, you take Death Valley Drive, you take any of those songs. I mean, you want to talk about heavy, you know, Eyes of Fire, you don't get heavier. That's our Kashmir, you know, you don't get heavier than that. Just put that on and tell me that's pop. So we had the best of both worlds, Street of Dreams and so on. Can't Happen Here, whatever.
what voice out there in that kind of world do you really admire or go, when you ever do hear it on the radio, it's like, wow, does he have a hell of a set of pipes?
Well, I mean, still, you know, from the classic era, like Paul Rogers, you know, I mean, he's still singing amazing, you know. I mean, there's a lot of good singers out there today. But the one thing, and I know I'm probably avoiding this actual point of the question, but the thing that I miss is the originality of the singers. It always seems they're always copying somebody from the past. You know, it's like the hardest thing that I had to do was to be me. And Roger Glover had said it. He said in an interview once that Joe Lynn Turner had found his own voice. That's the biggest compliment I ever had, because that defines you. And then when Joey Tempest said, yeah, I really admire Joe Lynn Turner singing and stylized himself a little bit after me, and so did others, that's a huge compliment, because that's what I did in the past. But at some point, you have to develop your own sound, your own style. And that's difficult. I find it just be natural about it. But at the same time, that's what I'm missing. And I'll go, this guy's a great singer, but he sounds like that singer a little bit. And that guy, and they all kind of blend together, you know? And I want somebody to come out and blow me the hell away and go, nobody sound like that. Nobody sounds like that.
As a rock fan, this is a really generic question, I know. Are you happy the way rock has progressed? And are we still rocking out in 2022? And well, I'm not trying to bring up Gene Simmons' Rock Is Dead. Nothing to do with that, but like how rock has aged.
Well, I think it's become a little cookie cutter. It's become a little repetitive. Everybody's trying to sound like, again, the same kind of format, you know? It's like metal, of course, even is starting to get a little bit like that. You know, the band before them, then the band after them. You know, there's only a few unique, like Rammstein will never change. I mean, you know, stuff like that. Metallica started their own channel of what they do, et cetera. Yet they got more popular, right? They started with, you know, when they started to hook up with the big producers in Sweden and so on. So, right. I mean, but I think we're at a little bit of a stalemate in rock, because it needed to be a little more adventurous. And that's why I think Belly of the Beast came out, and me and Peter got something that it's refreshing. It's a little different. It doesn't really sound like anything else, in my opinion. I mean, maybe you know something that sounds like it, but I certainly don't. I think it has its own personality.
It's very refreshing.
Thank
Absolutely
you.
Absolutely refreshing. It truly is. It truly is. A couple more quickies for you. Just a left field question. Was any interaction with the Sabbath guys in your career? Any talk about you being brought on board or?
No. I mean, I knew the guys. I knew them, you know, all partied with them at the Funny Farm and, you know, in London and all that kind of stuff. Because everybody crossed paths, you know, Robert Plant, you name it. But no, there was never like you should be in Sabbath, like Dio did, or even Glenn or whatever. No, I think I was always doing something else anyway that I probably, I probably wouldn't think that was particularly my cup of tea anyway. I think Ronnie fit them pretty well. I think Glenn did a great job. In fact, I like Glenn Iommi album. That's what I liked better. Then what's that? I mean, that record is a very cool record, you know.
And this may be blasphemy, but probably one of my favorite Gillan moments is Born Again. I love that Sabbath record.
There you go. Well, yeah, I'm sorry I didn't mention it, but you're absolutely right. But then again, you know, man, they've had just as many singers, I think, as Purple or Rainbow.
Twice as many.
Yeah. Wow. It's crazy when you start to think about it, you know. But yeah, that's right. I mean, it's a great record. And that's what you have to do. You have to take it on its own merits. And I think everybody's like, oh, bring back Gillan or get rid of Turner or bring back Dio. I love the Dio here. You know, hey, look, music, there's only two kinds of music, Tim, good and bad. That's
right.
It.
Right.
It
right.
really is. So.
Last fun question. We both kind of come from the era of fan mail. People used to put it on, write with a pencil.
That's right.
Mail it So for months it would take to get there, and then months, yeah, even if you got an answer back. Now, how have you adapted to social media where, well, obviously with this record, you saw the good and the bad comments like within 1 second. You get to, yeah, see, you know what I mean? It's how do you feel about that?
Well, it's instant up or down, right? It's like, right, bam, bam, you know? In one respect, I think it's healthy. It depends on how you take the comments. I even take negative comments. If it's a truthful negative comment, I think that can improve you. Because if it's truthful, but I don't take these haters and these losers and these trolls, or these, as they call them, internet morons, I've heard the term used, where they're just out to undermine somebody for the sake of it, you know? But if you could say, hey, you know, I think you could have been a little this way here, and I can, and that resonates with me, I'll be like, yeah, I'll do that next time. Thanks for the advice, you know? So it doesn't bother me. I don't get rattled. Richie told me a long time ago, don't let him rattle your cage. And that meant don't let anybody shake you up positively or negatively. He said, if you believe a good review, you better believe a bad review.
Right.
He says, therefore, I don't read any reviews. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. I know what I've done. And that's teaching.
Joe, you are an inspirational soul.